Good evening, one and all. Welcome to another Interact live stream broadcast where we interact with ourselves as well as any special guests that we have, more specifically on Saturdays, but every Wednesday night we have decided that we're going to do it on our own. So Jeffrey and I are here this evening. We are in Middle Region and we are at the home of our cousin Ted Richardson, former minister of TIAT, and probably during the program he's going to come on. So we want to welcome all of you live stream viewers, and we always say all around the world, you know where you are. We always appreciate when you indicate where you are live streaming from, so that it gives an impression as to where people are streaming from. So thank you very much for live streaming. Thank you for your confidence. Thank you very much for your loyalty. As tonight we're going to be just talking about any and everything, and with regards to the development of St. Maarten on a whole. But I want to get into a topic, but I wanted just Jeffrey to give his opening welcome remarks as well before we go into something that that got my concern a few minutes ago before we came here. I just want to just talk about.
Good evening to one and all. To all of you live streamers all over the world, I want to thank you for coming on and being a part of this live stream program for this evening, Wednesday, the 20th of July. This evening is going to be a live stream where we are going to be speaking to each other and about any topic. So get ready to ask questions about topics pertaining to St. Maarten and its people, because we are ready to answer and to give you information if we have that information, and if we don't, we're ready to go and get that information for you so you can have that information for yourselves. It's a pleasure always being on this program because it just keeps getting better. And we are so happy with all of you that comes on and live stream with us from time to time. Thank you very, very much. And I'll go right back over to Roberto now.
And I was just smiling a minute ago, sorry, when Jeffrey said it keeps getting better and better, because we have been having persons, friends, professionals, people all over St. Maarten, as well as family members who from time to time follow what we are doing, Jeffrey, on live stream and the subject we talk about, the seriousness of what we do. And some of them at the beginning of the programs, at the initial stages, probably a year or more ago, that would not have been, whether they were not interested or they were camera shy to come on with us, now they have finally said they want to come on to the program with us, and it makes us smile and makes us also feel happy to know that more and more of you are coming out and you are expressing your comments or your up to, or your whatever
appreciation
or what have you over all of the developers in St. Maarten or anywhere else that you want to talk about. But you know, before I came here along with Jeffrey, I saw a phone call, and I just wanted to mention, I saw my phone ringing, but I was at a distance from my phone, and it rang until it rang out, and then Jeffrey said to me, Roberto, you know, your phone was ringing, and then when I got back to the phone, it rang again, and the phone, it was actually just a number, and it was not a name.
Anonymous?
It was anonymous because there was no name, so a first-time caller then, you know, and you know, most of the time, all of us get these first-time callers, and sometimes we don't want to answer the call because we think that, you know, somebody who wants to bother us, or we think it's somebody that, you know, we may not know, or wrong call, but you never know. And I answered that call, and, you know, lo and behold, it was someone that, they don't know me directly, but they're probably their sister or their elder sister. Someone knows me from the church that I go to. But in any case, someone told them that because they were having a problem, they were crying so profusely, out of control. And I said, take it easy. And I could hear this, it's a very young person. It sounded like my daughter, but I know there's someone that is at a very young age, probably in their early 20s possibly. And they were so worried about whatever was going on with them. And I'm just getting ready for us to get to the location that we want to go to, actually in Middle Region here where we are with our cousin. And I asked him, what's going on? I said, take a deep breath. Let me hear what the situation is. Because I needed to know that if it's someone in distress, then I may have to be delayed. I would have to say, Jeffrey, we have to go here to help someone, or, you know, it was a life and death situation. So I thought about, for that minute, to just say we're going to have a 15-minute delay because we had to address that situation. But the whole point I'm making is that I spoke to the young lady and I said to her, take it easy. She started to get more relaxed. I said, listen, I'm going on live stream with my brother and we're going to be in for... we're gonna be on for 1 hour, and I should be available between 8:30 and 9. Don't worry about it, whatever it is. I guess she was talking about something with her job and the pressure she was getting on her job, and probably with her employer and somebody else, something like that. But she was getting pressure in the job that she has. But in any case, so I told her to take it easy, Jeffrey, and I said, we will call you when we get back, and I promise her that, and that I intend to do. But it's a situation like this that is happening every day, and there are people out there who are crying out. They're crying out for people to come to their help. They're crying out for good representation. They're crying out for someone who they know and who they trust and who they feel, because they've helped someone else in the past and they believe that they can help you as well. But you said a few things, Jeffrey, earlier this evening that I want you to repeat just for the record here for our live stream viewers to hear.
Yeah, a couple, maybe an hour or two ago, I was speaking to a very close friend of mine by the name of Nelson Els, and he was telling me something that is very interesting. I shared it with my brother pertaining to that issue, and he said to me, if you want to go in politics, he said it should be about people and not about power. I'm gonna repeat myself. He said, if you want to go in politics, it should be about people and not about politics. And that really, you know, shook me up. And I said to myself, he have a very, very strong point. And I shared it with my brother.
You know, and you know, when Jeffrey shared that with me, that impacted me so much, you know, because I realized and I understood, I keep understanding more and more the reason why we're doing what we're doing, and the reason why I have made a decision to do what I am doing, because it is not about power, it's about people. And I always say from time to time on live stream, or even when I write, you know, my notes, inspirational notes, or whatever I'm led to write that is in my spirit, I write that you have to love people. You know, what moves you to do something for someone is having love in your heart for people. And if you don't have love in your heart for people, Jeffrey, you can't do this. You can't be out there. You can't see you're there for people. When, let's say, we're using politics, for example, we're using politicians, for example, who are, let's say, in a campaign and before they're elected to office, they know everyone, they're running behind everyone to get their support. And then once they're in power, where they have the influence and let's say the position that they can help people, then it's almost as if they turn their backs on those people, the very people that they're supposed to represent. And that is something that concerns me a lot, you know, and that is why I wanted to touch on that, because so many of these situations are happening every day. From time to time, there's so many hurting people out there, Jeffrey, and that need someone to, you know, to come through for them, to help them, to be there for them. It can be, you know, a big brother or a big sister. It can be a teacher. It can be a mom or a dad. It can be a pastor, it could be anyone, you know, it can be your neighbor, but you know, more so it can be the people's representative. I'm talking about now people in government, can be those in government who can do something because of the influence and the power that they have to make a difference in not just an individual life, but in the people's of St. Martin's life. And, you know, I talk about the good shepherd that leaves the 99 and go back for the one that is in distress. And that is what it's all about, leaving the 99 and going to assist, to save the life of the one. And if it's not about that, then it is, then we're not serious and we're not committed and we do not love the people of St. Martin. You know, and I just wanted to just touch on that a bit, Jeffrey, and I don't know if you wanted to add to that, but that is what I wanted to really stress on, because it really changed my mode setting before coming here, because I came in a different mode, because we are going to talk about, you know, everything, but I needed to just get this out because of the seriousness of it. And and not only that, I gave the young lady my word that I'm going to call her back again, and I'm going to see what her situation is, to see in what way I can help her. Even if I cannot help her, I may know someone, Jeffrey, who can help her. And that's what it's about, because sometimes you may not be the person to help them, but you know of someone that can help them. And that is why in all of this, it has to do with you making that extra effort if you say you care about people and you say you love them.
That is what I said in the beginning, Roberto. Sometimes we don't have all the answers, but we can find the people that have the answers, so that those live streamers that asking us questions, they will be able to get the proper answers. You know, listen to you, Roberto. I realize that you're a person that really will be a good representative of the people because of your love for people. And that's extremely important. You know, I look at the way you handled the lady that called and stuff, the commitment you gave her that you're going to call her back as soon as you get back home. You know, and all of that made me understand, yes, you are the right person for the job.
And you know, and like you said that, you know, and I thank you very much for saying that, Jeffrey. And look, it's not just about what you say, but it's all about what you do, because there must also be a track record. And while I may not have been in elected office before, I have been in government for many years, which you know, and I've worked for many years with the representatives of the people in power and government on various levels, and I have that experience, and I have been exposed to a lot of distress cases where maybe it may not have been, let's say, whether the commissioner or the minister or the member of parliament, but the assistant, you know, who can let's say, address and respond to the situation, because it is not always the minister or the member of parliament who can solve the problem. Sometimes it's someone in their office who can do that. And rather than saying that you can't, make an effort. It's all about making an effort to do it because you can. It's all about making a phone call, because people out there, whether it's in the business community or whatever, in whatever office of influence that you hold, when in the office of a minister, of a member of parliament, the office of a member of parliament calls you, people do respond in a respectful way, and sometimes they then respond in a way to resolve the situation. So that's where we need to look at this. I have had my experience, so I know exactly the way how I will respond to things, because I've had these situations in the past, Jeffrey, and I know exactly what I would do because of that. And like I said, it has to do with you feeling the love and feeling committed to serving the people in your heart and in your spirit. Because, and not only that, because of what you've been through yourself, you know, when you've been through stuff like that too, it always plays back in your mind of that when you needed someone, someone was there for you.
Amen.
And now someone now needs you, and you need to be there for them. And it all has to do with sowing good seeds in life, because sometimes the seed that you sow for someone else, a stranger, is a seed that you harvest, that your children or a friend or your mom or your uncle or your sister, your brother, they can reap that harvest. It doesn't have to be that person does something good back for you, but
somebody else
related to you can be the beneficiary of that. And that's what it's all about, Jeffrey.
Yeah, planting good seeds. Nelson else was telling me about that as well. When you plant good seed, and you get a good harvest.
That's right.
You know, and that's very, very important. I want to take a minute out of our time and just acknowledge some of our very, very loyal
viewers, that's right,
live stream viewers, because they take it their business or make it their business to every Wednesday and every Saturday come on and look at and view our program, which I appreciate extremely, very, very much. We have Michel Artson,
yes,
our cousin.
Artson, yes.
I want to thank him. Edorna Dundee Griffin.
Not even as a Martin, he's somewhere overseas.
Yes. Exactly. Edorna Dundee Griffin. Your good friend, Oswin Adridge.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, he's
Rabbi,
on.
Rabbi Oswin.
Rabbi Oswin.
Hey, I also want to thank
and
him
our
family for supporting us.
And our sweet, sweet cousin, sweet poison, Richardson Tamisha.
Tamisha as well.
We want to thank. I don't know how come
Tamisha,
I didn't
Tamisha,
see.
That's Tamisha Milavision, huh?
Yeah, I don't know how come I didn't see Hamita's yet, Roberto.
She's going to come on. Probably she's taking care of our auntie.
But it's like a cousin thing today, because we have Roberto Richardson, our cousin, that came on as well tonight.
Okay, Roberto.
You want to thank him?
Yes,
yeah.
He made me sick.
Exactly.
And that's Roberto.
That's Bobby.
Uncle Bobby.
Uncle Bobby's son
as well. Yeah. We want to welcome him as well. And I'm sure there's some others that are going to come on from time to time. But as we said, we're going to be talking about, you know, everything. You know, I've made some notes here on my phone of areas we want to touch on. They are very, very, very popular subject that we have been talking about all of the time. I'm hoping that in between that, maybe probably our cousin and former minister of TIAT, the Honorable Thaddeus Richardson, if he would jump in and make some comments as to some areas that we may touch on. We're not pulling him into the program, but because whenever we are with him, he always gives a great contribution, and he just connects well with us, and we appreciate having him on the program to make his contribution. So sometime, you know, he'll be jumping in and out with us on the program. But I made a note here, Jeffrey, of areas that I was talking about, because I know, remember the last time we were talking with our dear friend and young brother David Richardson.
Yeah,
that is the David Richardson's junior.
Dookie.
He is the son of David Senior. That is the very well known Dookie in South Ward. And we started talking about the representatives in the districts. Let's say, whether the committee council or whatever you want to call them. And we started to talk about even having them become foundations where they can be able to get assistance, and we were talking about coming with an overall comprehensive plan as to how you are able to get financing for your projects based on the needs of that particular district, because every district has different needs. And so, but I made some notes. I ran down the A, B, C, D, E, F, G, you know, as I normally do, and I was just touching on the district and communities. So we talked about district and communities and how we need to improve the district and communities by way of having the people in the communities themselves. And we talked about that last Saturday. The people in the communities, the residents of those communities, have more of a say, have more of a contribution, have more of an input into their district as to the developments of their communities. Not so much in the broad sense as it pertains to, let's say, infrastructure that, let's say, Vromi would be responsible for, like sidewalks and roads, but more, let's say, in the areas of beautification, let's say...
Garbage collection.
Garbage collection. So then we were talking about having popular communities do the garbage collection on the streets, of those communities, and then have them bring them down into, move them into bins, not moving out of the district, but and also given an opportunity to the young people of that neighborhood, an opportunity for employment, for business, so I think they are able, let's say, to just stay within their community and bring the garbage collection down into the large bins in their district, and from there have the big companies that are awarded contracts by the government of St. Maarten then take the garbage from those bins to the point where they need to be distributed. So things like that we were talking about, you know, landscaping, and we were talking about, like we said, tie sidewalks, we talked about beautification and stuff like that. And then we were also talking about, you know, focusing on what we would want to do, and David touched on that, we want to do for the seniors, especially the seniors in those districts, as well as the young people in those districts. So that is something that we would want to touch more. Well, we leave that for a subsequent broadcast when David comes back on, and he'll be talking, because we ask him to come back and use the District of South Reward retreat. I think
it's Weymouth Hill,
as well as Ebenezer, as a model for the other districts. So, you know, we use that as a starting point for us to talk about the districts. But we just saw our dear cousin, former minister of theater. I know he's doing his own thing. He just came in, so you want to just say welcome. He's giving us a nod, so he's gonna come in eventually and give his comments as to the areas that we're touching on while he's listening to us. So you just want to say welcome to you, honorable former minister of theater, Mr. Teddy Richardson, and let us continue. We touch on the communities, Jeffrey. I don't know if you want to add anything to that, because I know that when we touch on the seniors, there are other areas that we have written here as we go along. As we go along, we'll be touching on those areas. But we talked about the communities and having it, you know, having, I like to use the word decentralized, in the sense of having the people of the communities by way, let's say, of community councils and foundations, to be responsible and to empower them, let's use the word, empower them financially to be able to take care of their communities, because they know exactly what their problems are, and they know exactly in their community where their problems are located. And that is also a way of empowering, in the sense of employing the people in that district, because from time to time we realize that our people are not finding work and they come from various districts. And you would be surprised to see that a lot of opportunities for them can be had in their own district where they reside. And that is something that we want to promote, we intend to promote in the future. And it is one of the visions that we have, that we are looking at to instill in project plans and proposals, so that we can empower our people. So I just wanted to touch on that, and then we touched on, let's say, we already talked about our seniors and what we can do for them. We don't have to, repeat what has been said from many of our guests, and as well as many folks out there in our government, as well as invited guests on various radio talk shows, etc., etc. And we also made note on C, we had prepared this within the district, that we talked about preparation for the hurricane season. We are not the experts in that area, But we just want to bring to your awareness the fact that we are in the hurricane season. So things like you're moving loose debris on your properties that can be missiles, and so whenever there's high wind, you know, from the threat of a hurricane or just a regular storm or so, or depression, things like that needs to be moved, and you don't have to wait until when there is a hurricane or a storm in our vicinity that puts everyone in a panic stage that they have to go and run here and they got to go to the groceries and all that. So we're just saying to you, we're in hurricane season, you know the steps, we know the drill. St. Martin's a very, very experienced country and island when it pertains to hurricanes. So we're just asking you to just focus on the fact that we are in hurricane season and do the drill. You know what you have to do, and please do what you have to do, which is necessary in your district. And that is one of the other points that we touched on. And then we talked about upgrading of the sidewalks. The upgrade of the sidewalk we touched on a little earlier.
Can I just go back?
Yes, you have some phone coming in.
No. Can I just go back? I just want to say hello to Ruby Danielle from Middle Region. She said she's a Middle Region woman. I just want to say good evening to
her. Middle Region woman?
Well, she claimed Middle Region, so she's saying she's from Middle Region. Yeah, I just want to mention a couple things that you said with regard to the districts. Last Saturday when we had the discussion with David Richardson,
yes.
You know, I want to mention that there are districts, like I can mention one for sure, Saunders District. There are districts that are very, very organized, and there are districts that are not so organized. My question to you would be, how will we get those that are not so organized, get them together so that they will have a district where they could at least approach of persons on a board of a district that they can approach in order to get certain, you know, things that they're going through under control?
No, you know, like I said earlier, Jeffrey, you know, every district, what their issues are relates to their specific district. But one of the things that, from experience, I can tell you that one of the things that I always say about these district councils is that they need to get to the level of where they become foundations. Because foundations are the entities that are
associations.
Well, associations, but foundations more so, because foundations are the ones that are receiving fundings from these various funding entities. And I know that Ted, later down in the program, he'll be able to correct me if I correct me. If not, he will correct me or agree with me. But funding agencies normally give funding to NGO, non-governmental organizations, which are normally foundations. So it is in the best interest of these district community councils, Jeffrey, to become foundations where they're able to receive request funds from funding agencies, or even from the private to the business sector. I also said in the last discussion with David too as well that
Can I butt in there a little?
Yes.
A foundation is actually an organization that has just a board members. An yes. Association is a association that has more than one member. So everybody that lives in that particular area will be a member of that association. I don't know if you want to use the foundation or the association will be a better bet.
No, but let me just, because what you just touched on there is very important to say, because the combination of the foundation and the association is very important, because the foundation brings membership, as you rightfully said.
The association.
The association brings membership within that community who will participate and give their contributions as well. But when I mentioned the foundation, I was taking it a step further as to how fundings can be, because at the end of the day, all of this has to do with money. And if there's no money, then it's very difficult to have these communities volunteer and to giving contributions when they themselves are hurting personally and they have their own personal things to take care of on their own property. And that is why I mentioned that. And especially with all that is going on, even since Hurricane Irma, Jeffrey, with all of the funding that are made available even to the trust fund and the project bureau, etc. So I mentioned the foundation in particular because I said that is where the association will be able to get funding as to what it. But again, it has also to do with what are the priority areas that are established that can be funded. So that is where it becomes not complicated, but that is where the terms of reference is established as to what funding is granted for. So not to get into that in details, the idea that we talked about is that every community, and we did last time talk about dividing St. Maarten into districts. We're talking about Dutch St. Maarten, the districts, and have each district then have a sort of a structure, a similar structure that they can work with to facilitate financing projects and programs that would necessitate their area and their needs of what they would want to develop in their community. You know, be it through learning programs, educational programs, or be it through physical infrastructure. So I was just mentioning all of that to say, and we talk more about one comprehensive plan where all of the districts, all of the community councils, all of the foundations can use that as a model to be able to get funding for whatever they want to have funding for. So that's what we touched on the last time. So I don't know if is anything else you wanted to contribute on that. But I don't want to go because there are so many other topics that I have noted here. So I want to go into those unless you have folks live streaming and giving their comments as to anything that you want to mention about. I'm going to continue and I talked about also with the communities that we talked about the sidewalk, upgrading of the sidewalk. We talked about, and this is personal to me, we talked about the road crossings, Jeffrey. We talked about road crossing, the pedestrian crossings, and I can mention one specifically there on the Cosulas, on the Bush Road. From Cosulas, let's say we had the Cosulas bus stop where KFC is, and we want to cross that road crossing to the to Carrefour, to the shopping mall of Carrefour, the former Grand Marché, and that road crossing, no matter how many people complain about it, that road crossing is not properly painted, and people are very scared to cross the road crossing because the drivers do not know. Let's say if there's a visitor coming from you have a tourist or you have whomever coming to the island who do not know that that's a road crossing because it's not properly painted, they will continue driving, and then the pedestrian, if they cross without checking, they can be struck by an oncoming car, and then you ask yourself who will be wrong. But the point would be is that the road crossing is not properly painted, and so are there many other road crossings in the other areas, whether it's in the districts, the communities, the neighborhoods, or on the main roads. So that is something that needs to be looked into very seriously, and we don't want to wait until something drastic happens or someone gets, you know, seriously injured or lose their life, God forbid. But we want to look into those things even as government, because it just takes paint, and it takes a paintbrush to get it done, and to have a yearly maintenance program that is budgeted to do stuff like that. So I'm just, you know, wanting to mention this on this live stream program, that is something that is not being looked at, because we have been talking about that for a very long time, and I don't know if there's not a budget for it. But at the end of the day, we are talking about people's lives and therefore it is the best interest, behooves the government of St. Maarten to see that as an area of priority to properly paint these road crossings for the safety of our people of St. Maarten. So I just, you know, I mentioned that, Jeffrey, in the list of things that we were talking about. We also mentioned here employment opportunities and privileges for our local people, neighborhood safety we talked about, and proper control of music on the public roads. So these are something, so employment opportunities and privilege, we could talk about that all day, all night. I don't think we need to stress on that, but that is one of the areas that is very important, employment opportunities for our local people. Then neighborhood safety in various areas, in various aspects, and I'm sure that would have to do with the control in the neighborhoods where at times crime is very prevalent. So that is also very, very important. And then also the control of music on the public roads. That is becoming a very serious problem in the district. It seems as if these persons who are in these cars, it seems as if they're creating discotheques in these vehicles where they drive on the public roads without any respect for let's say the sound, the decibel on the roads, and it is a disturbance, it is a nuisance to the people in all of these districts and on the main road. It's also very distracting because sometimes maybe a siren, a police vehicle or ambulance is you know, a fire truck is coming with a siren, and these vehicles are driving so loud that sometimes they themselves, the drivers, cannot hear or they cannot see, and they're so very much distracted, and they can cause a hazard, an unsafety hazard for everyone. So that is something that also needs to be looked into. And then I want to move on, and this is a very important area, and Jeffrey, I want you to jump in where you see the need to jump in. I want you to jump in where you see the need to jump in. I keep looking at our cousin, you know, and I don't know if he wants to get into the program or not, but I'm going to keep, you know, pressing him, because he has been part of government, so he understands a lot of what is happening, a lot of the realities that we have to face, also even on the level of government. And you know, with their constraints, even with budgetary constraints and all that, because we're very much understanding to that too, working with the government of St. Maarten. So we want to look at it from every angle, and then so we can have good understanding and be able to explain to people of St. Maarten what can be some of the areas of complexities in terms of being able to have financing readily available in these areas, whether they are budgetary constraints, you know, budgetary falls. So all of these things, you know, so you know what we're dealing with, you know, you the people of St. Maarten, you know what we have to face in these areas. But nevertheless, it is so very important for us to still mention them and bring them to the attention of our representatives, as well as bring them to the attention of the leaders and the community leaders as well, to be able to fight for the communities that they represent, and as well as our government to fight for the people of St. Maarten in the same manner. So I just wanted to mention that, and then I wanted to touch, and I made a mention here on the, and I made a note of, and it says as follows: proper building permit control for small businesses, and then along with control of especially small groceries, beauty salons, and small restaurants and food with the snack or trucks or whatever you want to call them in these neighborhoods. What I'm basically trying to say here is that we have been having more and more, I would say, an epidemic. I call it an epidemic as far as it relates to groceries being built or started in the districts and the communities and neighborhoods of St. Maarten. Even here in Middle Richard, for example, we did not know of so many groceries in one particular area. I think the last time I did a count, I think what would we count, Jeffrey?
Like
eight or even more.
Yeah.
Groceries in one district. And then you ask yourself, yes, one way, if they're not renting a space, they're building a space, a building. If they're building, that means they have to get a building permit. But here is where we see, let's say the Ministry of Rami, for example, and the Ministry of Tiat having to work hand in hand, because while they may have a permit to set up a salon or a grocery, at the same time, the Ministry of Tiat, which it has in its ministry also economic affairs, they would have to play their role as well as to say, are there enough groceries in that particular area? How is it zoned? What is the capacity? Can we allow more little small groceries in these areas that would affect the existing groceries and their business and the revenues as well as return, causing while new ones are open, we are seeing that some of the existing ones can be forced to close down. Is that how we want to develop our economy so that everyone can benefit? I don't think so. So it is very much important that we do not allow new businesses to come on stream to make existing businesses suffer. That is not how you develop a thriving economy. So these are things that we need to look at very seriously, and not tomorrow. We need to be addressing them today, because there is an ongoing pandemic of groceries, small groceries, coming up, and I would say sprouting out in every district, every neighborhood, and it's really causing a problem. It's the same thing that we had in the past also with the buses, you know, and we complained over the years about buses, whether we had too many buses or not, and then after a while we had to live up to the fact that everybody had to, the pie keep coming smaller and smaller, things like that. And that is why we have had individuals and businesses having to expand, or individuals having to look for two jobs because they cannot take care of their family, they cannot support their family in the way that they want to, ultimately having the family suffer, in particular the children not having their parents being with them because they need to support them financially, and so they have to work two jobs and they cannot give their kids the time. So things like that, you know, things like that, they have snowball effects, Jeffrey. And that is why there must be a comprehensive development plan. We always talk about it, but at the same time, executing is the issue. We were in a discussion the other day with Member of Parliament, Sarah Westcott Williams. I don't know if you can recall that we had a discussion with her, or probably I had a discussion with her by myself, we heard her speak. Oh, she was speaking on another program, and one of the things she said that sometimes Parliament can approve, let's say, a law or whatever, the legislation or whatever,
a motion,
it might be a motion or a law or what have you. But in any case, the Council of Ministers is the executive body, and they have to execute. And so if on the executive level it is not carried out, then it still stays ineffective, because that law or that policy or that legislation or what have you is still not carried out, it still has effect. It's the same as a government presenting a budget based on what they call a ramming. What is a ramming in English again?
Estimation.
On an estimate, so budgetary estimates. Thank you very much, Minister. A budgetary estimate, which gives an indication as to what the Council of Ministers expect to have as their yearly revenues. But if the laws or the legislations are not in execution, then those estimations cannot become reality, in the sense that revenues are derived from these areas, these specific subject areas of revenue generating. So things like that, all of these things are things that need to be addressed and seriously, very seriously, and where the attention needs to go. So it's not just one thing, but it's so many things that we have to look at from a comprehensive perspective. So I just wanted to touch on that, and as it relates to the small businesses, and you know, in the communities as well. So I don't want to stress too much on that, because everybody knows what that relates to. I don't know if you wanted to contribute to that, Jeffrey. I don't know, Minister, if you wanted to say anything on that area, because I knew that you were the Minister of TIAT. So I don't know back in your time as minister how it was addressed, but we're just trying as much as possible to give our contribution as far as that is concerned. All of you viewers can give your contribution as well. But those are the things that are always an issue for us. For us as a community, as St. Maarten and the whole, and we just wanted to touch on that as well. And then the other thing too that we mentioned here, organizing and properly structuring, establishing of business. I mentioned along the Walter Ginisbert Road. I don't have to go any further on that topic. We know exactly what we're talking about. That's the Pondville Road and how it needs to be organized, structurally organized, infrastructurally organized. I don't want to go into the details of that, because we all know what the issues and what the problems are along that Pondville Road. And I touched on the other districts as St. Peter, Soccer Garden, Middle Region, Dutch Quarter, and Cold Bay, etc. And so I want to move on quickly, because I know time is moving up. We are already at 7:48. And so we don't want to give I think the
minister
is coming, if he's
an opportunity
in,
to come in,
yes, because we've been asking him to come in,
yeah,
and I wanted to give some comments, because he's been following what we've been talking about. So we would really appreciate, you know, while he's not minister anymore, he can always contribute as to the experience that he had in his time in office. What were the some of the difficulties, the complexities, and because we are now, and we can say one thing, and then those that have been in office can say, you know, Roberto, Jeffrey, it just doesn't work the way that we say it works, but it goes with XYZ. So Minister, we want to welcome you to our live stream again, as always. Thank you very much for being able to use your home in Middle Region, as always, on a Wednesday evening when we are home alone. But we want you to comment on some of the things that we've been touching on, and feel free to start wherever you want to start.
Well, firstly, my name is Ted, not Minister. So Minister was a function in a short little while of my life. So I'm Ted or Teddy.
Okay, and, okay. You know,
Thaddeus, yes, officially. But I've been listening to what you say. Obviously, we only have 12 minutes to go, so it's not a question. I don't want to get too deep in anything. But one of the things that you just mentioned was quite interesting, which was a subject that had my attention in 2013 and 14, was the popping up of what we call supermarkets here.
Yes.
And I did a count sometime there from the corner shop, let's say from Cospro up until Grand Marché one day.
Where is
day.
That?
Cospro is at Madame Estate.
Madame Estate, okay.
Yeah, from that road until the
Carrefour.
I counted,
yes,
14 supermarkets.
14?
14.
Wow.
Yeah. And at the time, I brought in a moratorium to stop Chinese, Chinese, to stop supermarkets, because I think a supermarket is needed, and you can look at the population around it.
Yes.
And we were talking at the time about having economic zones.
Yes.
And by doing that, and by giving them a moratorium, because we had enough. I mean, how many supermarkets do you need for a population of so many people? It's
similar, exactly,
like hardware stores, any type of business. And at the time, we were busy with that, but after I left, they lifted the moratorium, because I was also seeing at the time that many of the grocery stores were popping up, and there was no kind of competition, because what they do is they buy in like a cooperative, and so you see the prices practically the same. You don't see the type of competition and not variety of products coming in. So that was an issue. So that's something you just mentioned. But I was always in for economic zoning.
Okay.
That means that you take a zone, an area, a neighborhood, and you look at the type of industries or the type of,
yes,
services that need to be provided, or the type of products that needs to service that. So if you look at a hardware, a supermarket, a barbershop, whatever, hairdressers, all type,
yes,
of different, and then you can decide per capita or per area,
mm-hmm,
what type of variety of stores that you need. Then you don't have a competition, but what you get more is a complement. They complement each other, and it brings more variety, and everybody gets to survive.
Okay. I have a question here for you, Minister. And they are asking, how many of the 14 is local folks?
It all depends on what you call local. Eh? I have a great difficulty in defining what's local.
Yes.
Because I just use America as a reference. I mean, once you pledge the allegiance to the flag, and you become American instantaneously,
yes,
no matter where you come from.
Yes.
But I think I understand the gist of the question.
Mm-hmm.
If I would define local as it look like me and you. Then I can't remember seeing one. I know the corner shop used to be, but I don't see them like that. So many of them are Chinese or Oriental owners. Then I think Carrefour and Cospro, by the way, I hear is from a local person or local, yeah, Antillean or
mm-hmm,
someone.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know exactly, mm-hmm, but there are a few, maybe, but little.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, I understand the question, and indeed, at the time when I put the moratorium, it was also because I noticed that they were used for director's license, and after so many years, you'd find the people them changing and leaving, and another set would come in,
mm-hmm,
you know, so I was always wondering why so many, and why they're competing. I mean, on the Illich Road, I think within area 50 meters, you have about four.
Wow.
But again, it is what it is. And I think that's something that those in government should address or could address. But it's very important, because it's not only the fact that there are a lot of them, but that means that all commercial spaces are used for the same type of business. And so if you want to do another type of business, it becomes different.
Teddy, you know, I have another question to ask you, because as much as we say we're running out of time, but this is so very important to me personally, but as well as for the development of St. Maarten. I'm talking now specifically, and it also relates to when you were Minister of TIA, that also has to do with the airport as well. Am I correct?
Well, the
airport, as a shareholder rep of the airport.
Yeah.
And I want to talk about it more in the area specifically as to the development of the airport, which I know that has been planned in phases over the many years, the expansions of the airport in many years. And what I'm going to get to specifically what I'm touching on, it has to do with little small developments that is still sprouting out on, let's say, the airport stretch, when we know that area and everything that is in on that area is temporary
temporary build, knowing that in signing off on with a, let us say with a contract resolution that states that the minute the airport needs the property for expansion, they would have to remove. Is it wise for any government at this particular point or in the future, while the airport may not have started its construction expansion, let's say, on that airport stretch with the expansion of the runway, etc., for taxiway, etc., is it wise for any government to allow its citizens to be afforded any type of permits, new permits, when government full well knows that the airport as a government-owned company has in its multi-plan to expand in that particular area? So I'm talking now specifically of the airport then as the entity for airport expansion and everything that is zoned around the airport. I'm talking about property and as it relates to, let's say, the Ministry of Rummy then also issuing permits, new permits, allowing, whether it's permits for a short period of time or a long period of time, it doesn't matter, but issuing these permits that eventually gives complication matters that become a problem for, let's say, the person then being issued the permit, having to be told that they cannot be there. I'm just saying that because then who is at fault? I don't want to get into those technicalities. I will say that all of the property, and I'm asking you that in your experience, all of the property in that area which is zoned for airport expansion, wouldn't it be wise for the government of Somalia, for the Council of Ministers, to transfer all domain lands in that area to the airport authorities for their eventual expansion of the Juliana Airport?
Yeah, well, that's it's a loaded question, and I believe that everything has to do with agreements. If you make an agreement, are you willing to keep to the agreement? So, I don't believe that if the airport has a master plan, it has been there for years, from my time already, and there's expansion, there's a whole big plan for it. But if it takes 20 years, why leave the land barren?
Yeah,
in those 20 years,
I just got that people can
use it. It's all about agreement.
And to use while sitting down.
Yes, exactly.
Yes. Somebody just put that.
Our country has a problem with agreements and keeping people to the agreements we made. So if you got a permit, just like in Carnival, during Carnival period, don't you give boots a period of months to be there, and after that they're gone?
Yeah.
The same thing could be done at the airport, and same thing. Because we don't uphold the agreements, or because we don't dare to break, to keep people to agreements, we come into problems, and then other issues are taken and other reasons are taken. For example, if someone can use that for 5 years, and the 5 years over, be it that the business is very successful, can the person then claim that because of the government they can't make no money no more? You can look at it as you got the chance to make money 5 years. So it's all about how you make the agreement. Can people agree? And people don't have to change the agreement if it's not mutual from both sides. So I believe, yes, it can, but do it in such a way and let the person in the agreement know that they have to move all costs that comes, etc. If you have a building and someone wants to put in something and he wants to amend it and change it, paint it and do whatever, you make a contract with them that, okay, you can do that, but you have to leave it in the original state.
Yes.
And it's done. So I don't see that as a problem. I think a lot of times we make problems bigger than they really are.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We can all agree to maintain. Again, everything is looked at to government to do everything for us. At the end of the day, you should provide for yourself. Government should facilitate. I think they should facilitate much more than they do. But government should not govern your life.
Correct.
You know? And decide what you want to do and which direction you have to go.
No, I totally agree with it, because like you said, that question is loaded, because based on your response there, I get it. Ted, I get it as to your explanation, because why have the land sitting there? But at the same time, everybody needs to live up to agreement. Meaning that when your time is up, you need to move.
Vacate.
But to vacate. But then if a new government comes and the government allows you to stay longer.
Again, it's about agreement, and government is continuation. And there's a lot of things. I remember one very controversial move that I made was when I allowed them to make operational businesses at Mullet Bay, because that area was just closed off and nobody could go there. And at the end of the day, now you see that there's activity. People used to go to the beaches on the French side. Now they're at Mullet Bay. We have some businesses on the side. Government can collect, and we're using our land better. I mean, again, Mullet Bay is very loaded now because of the issues that they have. But look how long we've left wonderful land barren. And that is what we're doing too much, I believe. And we have to make decisions. Obviously, land, we have a shortage of land, and you can't please everybody. Now, I've done an exercise in my private life once where I was working for a company, and I found, and I was cleaning a warehouse with some of the employees, and I found 10 beautiful polos of brand.
Yes.
But we were 13 people working. So I asked them, what shall we do? We have 10 t-shirts. I can give none of y'all and then just give it to clients and give it away. Or I can share it and then 10 of you guys, but 3 won't get one. So we made that agreement. Okay, let's do that. They said, so what was the fairest way to do it? We had a lottery. So we put in 10 different, 10 different numbers, and they can pull. At the end of the day, when the t-shirts or the polos were given away, 3 people didn't get. You know what I got then? They were mad now and felt, because they started using arguments, but the others always winning and I never winning. So I was thinking, shucks. So instead of making 10 people happy, I made 3 people unhappy. So, and this is the question, and this is what happens a lot in the country. When we make 2 happy, 10 become unhappy, and then they start to criticize. And then what happens is that you 10 then, and I can understand then, the people say, you know what, I'm not going to give nobody anything. Exactly. And then that's how come I believe that on the island, many times the foreigners get everything that we want, because if Jeffrey get it, Ted mad, but why he get it, I tell you. So we envy each other too much, and we, like they say, we... At the end of the day, when they share, and I've had many different, I've made very bold and controversial statements at my time. Those were like, Hitler, if there's a job and there's one of ours who can get the job and he's qualified, hell yes, I'm going to give that person the job. I'm not going to give it to a stranger. I'm not going to give it to somebody I don't know. Mm-hmm. Because we have to look after ourselves. Mm-hmm. I think any country, I mean America or the Dutch or whoever, when they go out and represent their country, they go to represent their country, their interests, their people. So every time that we do something for our people and we start to criticize each other, I feel very sad when I hear that.
You're getting a lot of people talking about what you're saying. They say they agree with you 100%.
Okay. Yeah, well, it's my point of view. Again, that's the reason I did it. I'm not a politician. I wasn't a political function. And yeah, automatically that made me a politician. But I didn't do anything for popularity or wanting to.
Yeah.
So at the end of the day, you just, you know, count and think what's wise to do. And the wise is for St. Maarten to look after St. Maarteners, for us to help each other, and for us to make sure that we don't fight each other every time the crab tried to crawl out of the belly, we pull him back down, you know? And we always looking to fight and to find out what is wrong. I mean, in general, if you ask somebody how St. Maarten is, I can tell you 1,000 things that St. Maarten does well. I heard you talking about the garbage collection. It's incredible that a country collects garbage every day for free, and that the country is so beautiful and clean. We look at the one area that's broken and gone. It's incredible that we have so much traffic on the island, or so much people come, and we don't, and it's resolved at a certain moment. I mean, if you go to Paris, London, New York, Miami, and everything, we don't have a traffic control. We have a management control of time. It is known that in every city or every country, the guy who lives the closest to the school is the child that always comes late to school.
Yeah.
And he doesn't have a traffic problem. The one who's the furthest away always is on time, because it's about planning. And everything is about planning. Everything is about managing expectation. Everything is always about. St. Maarten is so great. St. Maarten doubles its population in one day. And a few hours, in when we have 8 or 10 cruise ships, we double our population in the morning, in the afternoon, everybody is gone.
Yeah.
And the question is, how do we feed all of those people? We don't have no economic information at all of what we sell, what we import, what we
export. Very good point.
But still, St. Maarten never goes hungry. So we are wonderful people. I mean, there are so many different things that people are amazed and that how great we are. Everybody that comes to St. Maarten at the end of the day becomes a St. Maarten. I can tell you why. Because the island forever and ever has been dotted as the friendly island. It still is with all the foreigners. If we look at the situation after hurricane, after pandemic, crime rate is so low. So one or two or three accidents of people still, why do we look to criticize our
bring
own,
down our own
bring down our
yeah,
own
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Everything we doing it,
me as if it's so huge.
And there's one thing that I call it opinionism. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody has an opinion, which is great, but an opinion doesn't make something a fact. And we tend to take opinions and make opinions into fact. So even wrong opinions are doted and are given too much attention and pay. So I believe that really, really, this great island called St. Maarten has so many great things that we can talk about instead of just focusing on the wrong things constantly. I was just, by the way, I read yesterday that Curacao became champions.
Latin America?
Latin American champions in 6 different categories. No, 5 different categories. And they lost in one category. So I'm talking about softball and baseball, Italy, etc. And even in Holland. And the game that they lost, the one that they became sub-champion, they lost 1-0 against Puerto Rico.
Wow.
Now, they have the same problem. So now you're doing something great. Why don't you concentrate on the greatness and every time thinking about what we're doing wrong and looking to criticize each other wrong. Every time we achieve something beautiful and nice, it's talked about just one day and all the others, and then we look again. Ask somebody in general, how was your day? How many people tell you great? They're looking to find something negative to tell you. So sometimes I keep to myself because I'm like, wow.
What would be the reason then for people to still have an excuse to say?
I have a theory. My theory is that people believe that you make somebody feel bad if you tell them you're doing great and that you're wonderful. Sharing good news seems to be like something bad. And I believe that we have a system ingrown throughout the years that bad things are rewarded and are liked are stimulated, while the good things are like, you got to be crazy. You know, it can be. So if you had a wonderful day and you had a wonderful experience and you found out a way to do things, if you share it with somebody, I believe that's the most beautiful thing to do, because the other person can learn from it or use that as an example. But we tend to find that people call you then a boaster, a bragger, he wants to show off, etc., etc. And that's why many people who do things, I believe sometimes, tend to not tell you how they're doing and not share their benefits or their successes with others, because they feel that it means that it's gonna cause certain, you know, destruction or a certain
reaction.
I just had by the way, I'd like to share this. There was a inquiry, I think from the Vromi, on Sunday, and Lily came to ask some information about living situation, which was very good, but completely wrong questions were asked. It's supposed to be anonymous, and the question was what my name, and one of the questions was what was my birth date. And I'm saying, like, how can that be anonymous? And then the question was, how much money do I earn? So how do you expect somebody to answer you or to get accurate information if you become that specific? That information can be used against you.
Correct.
So, you know, things like that, which I believe are depart from good intentions, make people very skeptical. And could be used for the wrongness, you know. But again,
you touched on some very serious stuff there, and some very logical aspects of life. Well. And I don't know if it's just whether it's a St. Martin or a Caribbean thing, or is it all around the world for whatever reason. You know, people are just envisioning life like that. If there's not a bad story to share, then, you know.
I think that's what it is. That's why I love you guys' program. That's why I support it wholeheartedly. Is because I've learned of so many great people that are doing great things in life. We have so many smart people, brilliant people that are sharing their knowledge, their experiences, their commitment to the community through your program, and it's wonderful. And I believe we have so many, but again, like you said, the biggest problem is constantly people looking at repeating the bad things. Mm-hmm. Repeating that.
Before you continue, I just want to say hello to a gentleman that is very close to us. His name is David Arthur Richardson. He said good evening. So I just want to say hello to him. He's one of our constant viewers.
Okay.
Very good.
Good evening, David.
Is that what you said?
Yes. Yeah, so there's a lot of different things. And mostly, positivism is very contagious.
Contagious.
But we have to learn that it is, you know. Many questions sometimes. I do motivational and some training to people. And one time, sometimes I ask people this question, what's more important? Because we're always told that first impressions are very important, right? So my question was me, and I did a little training to some. I ask, what's more important, first impression or last impression? Question to you all.
Last impression.
I believe that as well, because the last impression makes you come back, makes you want to do it. And if you look at, for instance, St. Martin's, the build-up of the tourists that come to St. Martin, you find that there's a lot of repeat customers.
Yeah, a lot.
And people come back because their last impression, their total impression was wonderful.
Yeah.
Now, if we want to build our tourism product, do we do it based on trying to emulate others? Or do we do it by being the best that we can be and having a product as unique as possible? And I believe that the open-heartedness, the welcoming nature of all our people have always been, and still to date are, hence the composition of our population, that maybe 30% of the people are from here, or 30% even of the people can vote on the island. That means that we're very welcoming people, and that we still live in harmony, and that there's no fight, and obviously there's a lot of frustration, although that people are saying that they're not getting what they have rights to. But I find it amazing how great we can live in harmony on this island with that type of constellation, with that type of composition, and with that fact that we don't have riots and fighting and theft at a way higher scale than it should be, or should be, that it could be.
I have a question for you, Minister, because
Man, you've said so much in this this very short time. I wish we would have had you on for the whole program.
To be honest with you,
because I was very much impressed with all that you shared and the level of wisdom. My question is, should we continue to improve on what we are doing well, or should we try to put the focus on fixing what is not going well?
Everything goes together. Again, you know, if you have to go out, obviously you take a shower, put on clothes, etc., etc. But when you're going out, sometimes during the day you have to go to the restroom, other time you have to eat, other time. So nothing stops the other. I don't believe that there's competition. Nothing competes with each other. Everything can live next to each other. It's all about a preference and when do you choose to do what. So, number one, what you do great, you should continue doing great, and you should improve it if you can. But it's all about a balance. But what you're doing very poor, you have to put a lot of attention to do it good, or at least better than it was. And I think for individuals, for countries, for organizations, whichever it is, it's not about competing to the other one. It's about looking at the other one to try to be, you know, look, finding great example. But it's about bettering, becoming better than you were yesterday. So, you know, and becoming the best version of yourself. And you can do that by copying, by learning, by sharing, but also by giving away. You can get more too. By sharing, you can accumulate more. Even by talking and saying, expressing certain things, you become, as you talk and listen to yourself talk, you become also wiser, because you can get feedback as well, etc. So I believe that there's everything is a priority.
Somebody is telling you hello. So hi Ted. Iri Bombini from the harbor.
Okay.
That's a, what's your name? The deceased? Georgeson brother from the Domain Behir.
Hippolyte
daughter.
Okay.
You know Hippolyte daughter?
Yes, definitely.
Okay, she works at the harbor.
Yes, correct.
Oh, yeah, I know it. Yes, I know her very well. So, you know, but, you know, you got my brain working here.
You got my brain working here.
But if I were to say to you, right, because, you know, we talk a lot all the time, the three of us, you know, we share a lot, a whole lot. If I were to focus a lot on becoming as good as I can be, or improving or becoming better, would that make, if all of us then would improve on becoming better, would that eliminate what is, let's say improving to do what is good, would that eliminate what is going bad?
Obviously, because again, I believe everyone should lead without a title.
I'm gonna share a story with you, because this is a bit different from what you know. It has to do, you know, something that I shared a lot about integrity, and I said in Dutch, laat het licht branden, you know, allow the lights to keep burning. And this story, I keep saying it all the time. This story is with you in your bedroom, and you're hearing in the dark noise in the kitchen. You hear noise in the kitchen, and you come out of the kitchen, you go to the kitchen, you turn on the light. When you turn on the light, the noise goes. You turn back off the kitchen light, and you go back to your bedroom, and you hear noise again. You put on the light, it goes. How do you, we said what to solve the problem. We can either stay in the dark and try to catch whatever it is making the noise, or if we keep the light on, because what is actually making the noise are the cockroaches and the rats. If we keep the lights on, that's a known fact, if you keep the lights on, automatically the cockroaches and the rats will disappear.
They will stop moving.
They'll go to the neighbor. Let me put it in that way. They will stop moving. They will eventually disseminate. Basically saying that if we continue to do the good all the time, the bad will discontinued.
You know, there's a definition. I believe there's a definition of bad, because what's bad for you today might be good for you tomorrow.
That's right.
And what's bad for Jeffrey might be good for me, and etc. But it's all about interpretation.
Yes.
And the same thing with mistakes. A mistake is a way to grow, as long as you acknowledge it. To walk better, you have to fall down. In order anything,
that's right.
You have to go through stress and pain in order to further yourself. You know, studying hard, you have to make your brains work hard till it's tired, and sometimes you have to fail in order to grow back. It's all about resilience. It's all about determination. It's all about trying to, you know, get better. And obviously none of us are perfect, and none of us will ever be. So there will always be a problem. If it's not caused by us, it will be caused by force majeure, or by the world, or by others. The question is, what do we do? Do we lay down and do we blame the others, you know? And do we point the fingers? There's a book called Who Moved My Cheese. I don't know if you guys ever heard of it.
No.
But again, the question is, do you play the blame game, or do you say, like, okay? And again, this is wonderful about St. Maarten, and I'd love to share this. St. Maarten has been through so many hurricanes, and everybody says St. Maarten lost, and somehow St. Maarten came back.
Every time.
And every time, everybody been talking to me, and I get so angry at times, and they don't like talking to me when the conversation comes, because they always think doom and gloom. Oh, how people can live? How this can? Guess what? We always live and we always did. We had to sell out our country, give away everything for money to Holland, and guess what? We didn't get the money, and look how we are today. We got so much of millions and billions, whatever the amount was, to build back roofs, and how much were built and how much people, because we as a people understand that we are already independent thinkers and doers. However, we are a bit complacent, in the sense that we would rather the other do it for us. But at the end of the day, no matter what, look at your life. You don't have money to send a car to get serviced, but guess what? When the radiator overheats and the motor starts to jam, etc., etc., some kind of hole, you'll find the money to fix it.
That's right.
And it's 10 times more expensive than if you service the engine. We have this problem that people don't have enough money. That's true. Me and myself included. But we actually have an economy of 1 week. Three weeks we don't have money, and we can't do nothing, but somehow we survive that 3 weeks for that week, that month end, that we get paid, and then we give up all our money.
That week.
So if you look at it logically, just theoretically, if you can get your amount of money at the end of the month, it finishes within a week. How did you manage to live
three weeks?
So if you can do that 3 weeks, that means that your money, you can do that for 4 weeks. That means that your money doesn't have to finish in that single week.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is, basically, I know we don't have too much. We have a little, and we can get much more. But I believe that the little that we have, we can do better with. That's the only thing that I'm saying. And if you do better, if you portion yourself, and you know how to budget, or you discipline yourself to whatever you have to do it over the period that you have to do, then I think you will live less in scarcity. Mm-hmm. Because we're living more in scarcity than we are in happiness.
So basically, the responsibility falls with us. We, you're saying that we are the ones that have to fix it.
I mean, I believe that every single person has the responsibility to himself, with himself, to fix whatever is broken, and that he is at fault for the situation, although he might not be. If you adopt that type of thinking, that means that you will do something to change it.
To change it.
Because if you give the other one the fault, and it is what it is, at the end of the day, you're not making the best of the opportunity, or make the best of the little, or what you don't have. And that's where creativity comes in, because at the end of the day, for instance, our economy is one that we have to, and it's been like that, and I live that way too, that we have to import everything, that we have to buy things, etc. And that we're not fending for ourselves. But when we got into the pandemic, myself, I came to St. Maarten, living here with my mom, I started to cook much more.
Yeah.
And I realized that the budget that I was spending, hey, listen, I got through all of those things, and I even got fatter. And I was living better, and I did a lot of different things. So now when the market opened back, the question is, do I need to spend the way I used to spend, or can I continue living the way I was living with the limited budget that I have?
Correct.
And so that's a way of looking at it. So if the next day you start spending back again and you don't have and you're living in scarcity, maybe you should ask yourself if it isn't your own fault. And again, what I'm saying, I'm not talking about others. I just look at the way that I analyze myself and how I've been living, and the people around me, and how we've been surviving. And actually, we're not only surviving, we're prospering.
Yeah. I have Rafalski just came on. He said, have a good night. But he said, I did enjoy this dude. He enjoyed you.
That dude is our cousin, Rafael.
That's our cousin. Our cousin.
You know? We're out of time, actually.
Yeah.
We are out of time.
That's why I didn't want to come in. Because
No, but we wanted you to come in. We forced you to come in. But we want to wrap it up here. I just want to, unless Jeffrey has anything else to say.
No. There's a lady that saw us this week.
Uh-huh.
She came on, and I would like for you to say hello to her. I think she's Jonas, Beverly Jonas.
Who has to say hello to her? Ted or myself?
Yourself. She saw us in Kobe.
Beverly Jonas. Beverly Jonas is, see, her name sounds familiar, but.
Jonas from on the porn side here?
Yes.
His wife.
Oh, yeah, we met her.
But she said she never ever missed this program.
Correct.
That's never misses this program.
You know, like you said that to Ted, we have so many people that Jeffrey doesn't see on the screen and is watching us all the time, you know. And but I in wrapping it up, because I think Jeffrey, if you don't have anything else to say, I would want to wrap it up here. But I want to ask you. I'm going to address you as Ted,
okay,
but as well, please, you're welcome. But I also want to address you as minister, and I want to tell you why I'm going to say that. Because you have had the opportunity that so many other people in St. Maarten haven't had, being an appointed minister. And you have sat in office, and now you are not in office anymore. And looking back at your time in office, and if I were to give you 30 days, this is now a, call it whatever kind of question you want to call it.
Yeah.
If I were to give you 30 days more, or 60 days more, or whatever time you would need to fix something that you didn't get a chance to fix, or you would want to fix in the portfolio, the ministry that you had in TN, what would that one thing be? And I want you to close on that, and I want you to be very honest with our live stream viewers. Tell them the truth. That is what we are about here. But talk the truth. Don't make me feel bad. Don't make me feel bad, Ted. If there's one thing, if you were to have 60, 90 days to go back in office as a minister of TN at this very point in time to fix something, what would it be? No.
Okay, let me tell you what my objectives were for the time that I was in office. I had three things that I wanted to do in analyzing the situation that we're in at that time. I wanted to come in and finish the good things that the ones previous to me did already that brought it to a certain level.
Yeah.
Continue and finish that, because I believe again that so many great things have been initiated, and it would be nothing better than just to finish it.
Yes.
You know? Then I would, if I got 30 days, the same as when I had 2 years, I would start doing things that I know or I believe or that I'm certain or that I, you know, I'm confident that I can finish within that period. Mm-hmm. And the third thing that I did and that I wanted always to do is to empower those who are left behind to do whatever they have to do for government to continue doing it. So one of the things that was important for me was to empower the ministry, the ones who are permanent there, because politicians are of a passing moment.
Yes.
You know, especially in those days, we were there two years and some were there just a few months in. And I think now we have the longest sitting government,
yeah,
which is something great. But again, you have a period to finish stuff.
Yes.
So, but the civil servants are there forever and ever. And I believe that the way everything is done nowadays, they have to flip-flop too much and go to this one, and there's no constant, like let's say, management or strategy or vision that's prolonged over a longer period. So what we have is, by those who have been in government or those who are sitting at that particular moment,
okay.
What you find is that you have people that constantly have to change depending on the weather, meaning government they're in and whichever. So I can understand that frustration. So one of the major things for me was to have the civil servants in such a way, or to leave the organization in such a way that it can perform at its highest level and that it can do what it needs to do in order to keep the country running. And again, as I say, you know, there's in Dutch, there are two words that sound almost the same, but they're completely different. There's one called dankzij.
Yeah, yeah.
And the other one is called ondanks.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and sometimes you have to know the difference. So one is like thanks, because of, and the other one is despite.
Yeah, yes.
You know, and I think many times those two are confused. Sometimes something happened despite the fact that we've made progress despite all the wrongdoings, mm-hmm, or whatever. And there's thanks to. And it's so difficult nowadays to find out which one of the two
to use
in a particular situation. And I believe that there are many people, those sitting in government now, who are doing a wonderful job according to me, based on the hand that they've been dealt. But on the other hand, which I do believe, and I'm sure that they can do even better than what they're doing, but
on dunks.
Is happening. So what I'm saying is that we should be critical in analyzing, but very careful in criticizing. Mm-hmm. And that's what you find always with opposition and coalition.
Yes.
And those in parliament and those in government. And because they switched, all of them who have been in, who are called in coalition, if they haven't been in a position or in parliament, have been in government or will be in government or have been in government. So that's not a problem. At the end of the day, when they're in it, they know it's completely different. So aspiring politicians, everybody are about giving away and helping the elderly, like you were saying, and doing that, which we know is needed. But then when you come up now, of course I know what's wrong with this house and what I can do and to fix it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But then I have to look in my pocket and then I can't, right?
Yeah. Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
So why make people crazy and talk about making myself crazy as well as looking at putting carpet wall to wall and doing all the other stuff? I have to live with the reality. And there comes this point, and that's why I was happy with the ministry that I was in. If you don't generate money, if you don't get money, how can you spend money?
That's right.
So why don't we put attention into making money? And why is it considered dirty for people to be hustling in making the moves to improve and to make our country and our people rich? It's not as if it's wrong. So we're concentrating more on giving away than and while we're in a deficit, then generating. So basically, those are the things that if I had 30 days, I would like to try to continue stimulating people as to look at yourself and try to make money. The hustle mentality. I don't care about law. Yes, I do care about law. Let me not say it wrong. I think that laws are there to help and laws are not there to stop. So even a law that if you drive more than X kilometers an hour on the road because it's there to help, it's not there to stop you from doing it, but it's here to make you adhere to what's coming. And it sounds very contradictory, but again, if you do control in the supermarkets for pricing or whatever, it's not to stop the business, it's to stimulate business by making them do such a thing that others can make more money.
Correct.
So even if you do control, it's to prevent people from getting sick. But we look at the reprimand more and we concentrate on they close the business. No, let's concentrate on if they stimulated the business and others to do better business, to become a better corporate citizen. And the same thing. You know, crime from happening is not by locking them up and pouring lunch, is by giving them something to do and giving them more empathy and making sure that they're socialized in society and making them feel loved and wanted, etc. Second chances, do we concentrate on that? How do we give somebody a second chance? How does somebody who has failed somehow, gone bankrupt, did this, lost a job, how do we forgive them or give them a second chance to become productive in our society? Mm-hmm. If you don't do that, what is he left to do? You know?
Yeah. You know, and you know when you say that, because I always like that, you just statement, Ted, I always say it, and sometimes people try to understand what I'm really trying to say, you know? And it has to do with the aspect of when you talk about the law, then I want to interpret it the justice system, for example.
Yeah.
And I always say, because you didn't want to you didn't want to lean on breaking the law, because you're trying to correct
just,
that.
Yeah, just an example. Yeah.
You said it. You wanted to say something
different? No. I wanted to give a there are a lot of people who do not have a legal status on the island. Let's call it illegal.
Good example.
But there are a lot of people who should be legal who are illegal. Mm-hmm. Children who are born here but never were, could not be registered because their parents are illegal here, but they go to the school system, they go to the medical system, etc. They should be made legal immediately, I believe, because then they can contribute and they can be a functioning part of the society. People who if they have an illegal status and you can't throw them out here because you don't have enough prisons, you don't have enough flights out, you don't have the system nor the money to get it organized, then organize them here for the time being that they're here and make it in an interim situation. Same question and same answer. For the airport area, if it's not being used, why not facilitate that it can be used within that and make agreements? And when that agreement is done, then do that. I mean, you have to fix the situation for what it is. And we have to learn with society. We have to live in reality. We're not ostriches that we put ourselves, our heads in the hole. So we have to, if the fact is that it's going to rain, although I don't want it to rain and my stuff is going to get wet, I get a top hole. But a top hole at that particular moment isn't beautiful, isn't permanent. But guess what I need to do? Protect what I'm doing at that particular moment. And I believe that we're in the situation where because we don't have the resources, because the situations are the way it is, because of different things, sometimes use quick fixes, but make sure that you have the discipline to turn it back whenever you have the chance to do it good.
Okay. Yeah. Correct. You know, and that's why I want to go back to what I always say, and that has to do with the justice system. You know, I want to from that angle, and I always make this statement that I always say the justice system is while the justice system is, has to uphold the law, I also see the justice system also in terms of helping to help to build and develop, whether it's a community, it can be very tolerant. And if you understand what I'm trying to say, then I always say the justice system is very tolerant in line with what you're saying of the legality, people not here, you know, people here illegal, or people, you know, they want to get their rights, they want to get it up, but the justice system of it is very tolerant for us who, let's say, have to put in place, and I'm talking about us as government, to put in place whatever needs to be put in place for them to be legal or whatever. The system is very tolerant in order for us to fix things.
Okay, there are two things.
So you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, I understand exactly what you're saying. I believe that, I understand. You know, there's statements, huh? There's legal and illegal, and there's temporary, there's grace period, there's lots of different things
that you
can do, which doesn't deem one immediately illegal, right? And I think in everything that you do, you should be creative. Again, the punishment and the action should merit a result that you want, should give you a result that you want. So if, and we know about that, if there's an insurrection or something happening and police becomes too aggressive and starts arresting everybody, it might get bigger, instead of you controlling the situation, it might get out of hand.
Yes.
Right? So law enforcement, justice system, rules and regulations, and so many of them are broken because they implement rules and regulations and laws, etc., at moments that it's not appropriate to use them. So you don't have to change it, but when do you do certain things? So if there's famine and poverty all around, and there's a warehouse or whatever full of food where the people can eat, and no one is opening it. So if the people break it, do you shoot them? Do you arrest them? You know. So it's all about that. But now I'm taking extreme examples, but I believe that it is prudent to be wise and to consider what the consequences of not having a law, what the consequences of having a law, and what the consequences of imposing the law, what those can be before you start talking about that. I hear everybody so adamant of bringing this law and bringing this law, but we have thousands of laws in which we don't implement, or which we don't control.
Yeah.
So, you know, what's the use of bringing in another one that you're not going to be using any of?
Yeah.
You know, start using the ones that you have.
Roberto, close off.
Yeah, so I want to... Rightfully so, Minister. I want to thank you very much. We've gone so much so over the time.
Sorry for
and,
that.
You know, you don't have to be sorry for that. I think we're going to continue with this. We left off, and for a matter of fact, we're going to follow back up on this discussion so that we can take another program with you and start right from the very beginning, because it's very interesting that we've had this discussion, because it has gone in some direction. I know a lot of our live stream viewers,
Agnes Felipe,
saying, yes, they can be. Hi, Agnes, good evening to you. We want to thank all of our live stream viewers for, again, you know, coming on as much as they do and as often as they do every week. Thank you very much. We want to wish you all a pleasant Wednesday evening. We're looking forward to see you on Saturday afternoon coming, when we have another Interact live stream broadcast with another special guest. We've been having so many requests for guests, and they have been, we used to start that with asking people to come on. Now everyone is asking us if they can come on.
You know, that's why I didn't want to come on. To tell you the truth, let me tell you the real reason. The real reason why I didn't want, because I enjoy listening and looking at others that I didn't want to be in the program. So if I'm in the program, I can't hear and know all these beautiful people and wonderful people that you guys
do every week. But you don't be. Listen, you have two choices. if you're gonna leave us, do the program, and you're gonna do something else, then we don't have an excuse to pull you into the program.
Yeah, but I came in last minute so that you guys don't call me.
Yeah, and even if you come last minute, you're gonna fit in. Yes. Well, we want to thank you very much, and I just want to say, honorable minister, want to address you that way. You know, so this is Maarten. These others we don't do that, but when you go to countries like neighboring countries like St. Kitts and Nevis and all of the other independent islands, once minister, always minister. You know,
I'm honored. Like, by
yeah. And you brought a lot of wisdom there.
Yo,
you
know,
to all the viewers, to your cousins as well. We learned a lot from you. I made a lot of notes. Because as you know, I have in the last week Wednesday, I don't know if I was here. We were here.
Yeah.
But I don't know if you heard when I said that I am going to be positive myself. I'm going to be running
I think
for
he
office,
was
a, political
yeah,
office.
Yeah,
so it's not a secret that I'm going to be running for office. So I just wanted to say that again. So having you as one of my cousin mentors, you know. Publicly on live stream, you know, it gives an indication as to that, you know, I'm on the right direction, being, you know, being managed by you and the type of wisdom and the type of experience that you have. So I have the right people around me. I just wanted to say that to you. We want to thank you all for coming on. Jeffrey wants to thank all of you. Ted himself wants to thank you. We thank you. We are live streaming here from Meridian, as always. Our hometown, the three of us. You know, the butcher land.
Three of us. Said,
you know, but the three of us, yes, three cousins and brothers and everything. We want to thank you. God bless you. Have a safe night until we see you next Saturday afternoon, God's willing.
God's willing.
Thank you for tuning in.
Good evening.
God bless you.
God bless.